We're in Acts chapter 7 this morning, and we're going to be moving very quickly today, and we have a lot of text to clear, so buckle up this morning. In Acts chapter 7, we find that Stephen is going to give his defense for the gospel of Jesus Christ. It was last week that we were introduced into the man, Stephen, and really that's what the message was about, the man. We found that in the Word of God that it said that Stephen, as it described him, was a man who was very full. It said that he was full of faith. It said that he was full of wisdom. It says that he was full of the Holy Spirit of God, full of grace, full of power. What a wonderful description of this godly man. And he was going to stand before the religious leaders of his day to give a defense of the gospel and not just defend the faith. He is going to contend for the faith. He is going to fight for what it is that he believes. Because if you remember, they have basically accused him of what amounts to capital crimes. There was nothing you could have said worse against you in this Jewish community than for it to be said of you that you are a blasphemer. That means that you take the things and you call evil what God calls sacred. It was said of Stephen by these religious leaders, not because it was true, but because they couldn't win the argument with Stephen. Here is Stephen, when they look at him, he has the face of an angel, filled with the Holy Spirit of God, contending for the faith. They can't debate him. They can't argue with what the Word of God says. And so rather than defeat him with words, they simply bring forth those who will basically bring false accusations against Stephen. They say you blasphemed against God. They say that Stephen blasphemed against Moses. They say that Stephen blasphemed against the law of God and against the temple. Those four things are what he stands to defend today. That indeed it's not him, because he's going to turn this upside down and backwards on them. He's going to do what we've seen Simon Peter do. He's going to do what we've seen Jesus do. At the end of this message, he's going to say, indeed, it is not me who has blasphemed against God and against Moses and against the law and against the temple, but he's going to say, it's you. He's going to look them in the eye and have the courage, and he's going to love them enough to say, it is you who have been stiff-necked. It is you who has been rebellious. It is you who has blasphemed against God, and he's going to challenge them. Unfortunately, what you're going to find is that they have one of the weirdest invitations that you will ever see after a sermon. Literally, rather than heeding what it is that Stephen is saying to them, it says that they become so angry, they begin to gnash their teeth, and literally, it says that they will cover their ears and charge Stephen. My goodness. In the end, they'll stone Stephen. And Stephen will become the first Christian martyr. I want you to see this morning that as he gives his defense for the gospel of Jesus Christ, he begins in chapter 7, and he's going to speak of three major characters in the Old Testament Scripture. In fact, he's going to use these characters to describe what this journey has been like for the Jews from the beginning when God called Abraham, all the way through their wilderness wanderings, all the way through the tabernacle and the temple being built to the present day. There's two overarching themes that I want you to see as I read this. Number one, we serve a sovereign God. Listen, that means a God who is in complete control. That means a God who has always been active and moving throughout history. We don't dwell on this planet just pointless and purposeless. We don't walk around day by day without any point to our existence. I want you to know that from the very moment God created you, He had a purpose and a plan for you. When He chose these people to be Israelites, to be Hebrews, I want you to know that He had purposes and plans. He had given them promises. And when it looked like things were out of control, He reminds His people there was never a moment. Listen, church, never a moment when God has ever one time been out of control. He's sovereign. More than that, the sovereign God who has complete control, you know what else we know? He extends to us amazing grace. That means He gives to us what it is that we don't deserve. That means that we serve this God who is in control, and we can be confident that He loves us, that He sees us, that He knows us, that He cares for us. And throughout the history of Israel, you see God acting on behalf of His glory and our good. Isn't that good news, church? But you're also going to see in this story that man has a propensity to reject the sovereign grace of God. We're going to see that man has within him a rebelliousness. That man has within him the full capacity to reject God, not once, but over and over and over and over. And He's trying to get these men to understand that is where they sit today. Stephen is going to say, I have received God. I have believed on Moses and the law that He gave to us. And I fully understand what the law means. I fully understand what the temple and the tabernacle means, where God dwells. I understand the Scripture. It is you who have been blinded, who have become stiff-necked. It is you, He says, who is guilty of all the things that you're charging against me. Let's look at it. Chapter 7. And I want you to remember, let me say this, one more thing. Stephen is not an apostle. What is he? What is he? He's just a disciple. What we would say, an everyday guy, right? This is what we would say. He's a layman in the church. He's just a man who loves and worships and serves God. He loves Him so much that he knows His word. And in this moment, you would think that God would need to rise up, maybe one of the apostles. But no, you know what he does? He looks around and he finds this faithful man of God. See, we sometimes think, even pastors, more highly of ourselves than we ought to. That God needs us, right? There was a story, I'm reminded of this guy, Ray Donovan. How many of y'all remember a name, Ray Donovan? You probably don't. You know why? Because he was the Secretary of Labor for Ronald Reagan. But he had an interesting situation. There was a day in Ray Donovan's life where he literally was given the opportunity to fly on Air Force One. In fact, he was the only cabinet member on this trip. And he began, he said, to think so highly of himself because there he is, sitting in the cabin behind the most powerful man in the world. The only cabinet member, he envisioned that during this long trip that they would be taking on Air Force One, he could see himself sitting down with the president, and the president would be asking him questions that might change the course of history. And he said, in all these thoughts of where he was and who he was with, he said, all of a sudden, a man came down beside him, one of the aides of Ronald Reagan, and he said to him, the president wants you to come in approximately 15 minutes to his cabin. He wants to speak with you and have lunch. I mean, you can imagine. He is thinking, I wonder what it is that we are going to talk about today. I have the president's ear. What is he going to ask me? What are we going to discuss? How am I going to shape the future of the world? And he says that in his heart, he just kept getting more and more puffed up. And he said that in 15 minutes, he went and he knocked on the door of the president's cabin. And the president said, come in. And in that moment, he said, literally, there was a red phone sitting on the desk of the president's desk there on that plane. He said, the second I walked in, he said, that red phone rang. And he said the president picked it up and he kept saying, okay, okay, okay. And you can imagine what this guy is thinking. He is thinking, what earth-shattering thing is occurring on this globe at this moment that when he hangs up, he is going to look to me for advice. He's going to look to me for some answers maybe, and we're going to work this thing through. And he kept listening. The president said, well, then I need to know, what are my options? And in the next breath, the president said, then I think I'll have iced tea. And in that moment, you know what he realized? He's just going to have a sit-down meal with the president of the United States of America. Sometimes we think that we are supermen. Sometimes that we think we ourselves are the messiahs. I want you to know that, you know what? God will use any and every man for his purposes, and that includes all of you. It's not some special men or women. It's not elite Christians. If you bear the name of Christ, then listen, He wants to do amazing things through you. And it ought to humble us when we consider what God wants to do. And in chapter 7, here is the message that He gives, the defense of the gospel of Christ. It's the longest sermon that we have recorded in the book of Acts, and really outside of the Sermon on the Mount, the second longest in all of Scripture. And here is Stephen's defense. The high priest said, "Are these things so?" What things? The four things that they said. Did you blaspheme God? Did you blaspheme Moses? The law, the temple. Is it true what these men are saying about you? And he, Stephen, said in verse 2, "Hear me, brethren and fathers." He's going to answer in the very first sentence what he thinks about God. That he's not blaspheming God. He knows God. He believes God. He trusts in God. He knows exactly who God is, and God has forever changed his life. He says, the God that we are talking about, that you say I am blaspheming, I know who he is. He is the God of glory. This is only the second time in all of the Scripture that this description for God will be used. Once in the Psalms, and right here in the book of Acts, he uses this term, the God that we serve, the God of glory. You know what that means? He is the God who is sovereign. He is the God who is King. He is the God who is Lord. He is the God that is like no other God. There is no other God. He is the only one true God. It is saying, when we say, use the word glory, that when you look at God, you can't help but see His omnipotence, His omniscience, right? His omnipresence. We serve a God that is faithful. We serve a God that is loving. We serve a God that is kind, that is just, that is faithful. We serve a God who literally stands so far and above any created thing. He says, this God that I serve is the God of glory. He's sovereign. He's gracious. And he says, let me tell you how I know that. And he starts to recount history. He says, the God of glory, this God that you're talking about, he appeared to Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia, before he lived in Haran. And he said to him, leave your country and your relatives and come into the land that I will show you. He left behind the land of the Chaldeans and he settled in Haran. And from there, after his father died, God had him move to this country in which you are now living. But he gave no inheritance in it, not even a foot of ground. Listen to that. You know what he's saying? He's saying we have a God who is sovereign and a God of grace. So God found this man, Abraham. He's saying, remember our history. He didn't choose Abraham because Abraham was good, because Abraham was righteous, because Abraham was better than anybody else. In fact, he says that he just looked and found this man, Abraham, when he lived in Ur of the Chaldeans. That means, listen, he was a pagan. He didn't worship God. He didn't know God, but God knew him. Aren't you glad that God knew you when you didn't know Him? Aren't you glad that He was seeking you when you were running from Him and didn't even know it? And He reached out of heaven and He chose you. He reached out of heaven and He called you. And He says, this is a story of the men of God. Here was Abraham, and it was God's grace that called him out. It was God's grace that gave him promises, that gave him purpose. And God calls out Abraham. And he says, I have a place that I want you to go. He didn't even really tell Abraham where he was going. And he says, by the way, this call that I've placed on your life, it's going to cost you everything. You need to leave your country. You need to leave your family. You need to leave your friends. And you need to trust me that I have a place that is far greater, a place of promise for you and for your children. And then Abraham's like, whoa, wait a minute. I'm way too old to have children. And what does he say? No, you're not only going to have children, but out of you are going to come kingdoms. Your descendants are going to number the stars in the heavens and the sand on the seashore. My goodness. You think God is able to keep His promise? Yes, because He's sovereign and He's gracious. And Stephen says, let me tell you about the God that I serve, this sovereign, gracious God. He's the one that chose Abraham. I know who He is. And beyond that, he keeps going and he says, but God spoke to this effect that his descendants would be aliens in a foreign land that they would be enslaved and mistreated for 400 years, he says, God has this sense of humor. He has this way of doing things that aren't really our ways. And he calls Abraham and he gives him a land and he gives him descendants. But I want you to know that in the midst of what God is doing, he's going to do things that you don't understand and you don't get. Because before you ever inherit this land, and you have to understand, Abraham never inherited the land himself. It says not even a foot of ground was his. The only ground that Abraham ended up owning by the time he died was only the land that he would be what? Buried in. Now, he lived in the land, but he didn't possess it. He saw it, but he didn't possess it. But God said, your children will. And then he tells Abraham this strange thing that he probably couldn't comprehend and couldn't understand. He said, your children are going to at some point be enslaved. Listen, 400 years. How many generations is that? But you know what he knew about God? The same thing Stephen knows. He's sovereign and he's gracious. And he knows what he's doing, and he never fails to keep his promises. And even though we're going to be enslaved, look at the words of God. He goes on and says, you're going to be enslaved for 400 years, mistreated for 400 years, in whatever nation to which they will be in bondage, I myself will judge, says God. And after that, they will what? They will come out, and they will serve me right here in this place. God is sovereign. He's gracious. He keeps his promises. He says, I'm going to pull them out. He gave them the covenant of circumcision. So Abraham became the father of Isaac, circumcised him on the eighth day, and Isaac became the father of who? Jacob. Now, these aren't the only sons. We know of Esau, right? But he's saying that God's promise is coming through Jacob. And then Jacob has how many sons? 12, and they make up the patriarchs of Israel, and God is building a nation, and God is building a people, and he says, the sons of Abraham, they're going to go into bondage 400 years, but know that God's going to call them out. God's going to save them, and they're going to serve him. Isn't that just the story of our salvation? Circumcised on the eighth day, Isaac became the father of Jacob. Jacob of the 12 patriarchs. The patriarchs, they became jealous of Joseph. So he's telling history very quick. And he says he sold him into Egypt, yet God was with him. So enter Joseph. He says, all these years later, Abraham is dead. Isaac is dead, but Jacob and his sons are living in the land of promise, though they haven't really fully possessed it yet, and they are taken into slavery. God has a purpose. God has a plan. He raises up a man named Joseph. It is one of the sons of Israel, one of the 12 tribes. He raises up Joseph, and you know what Joseph was meant to be to the children of Israel? A deliverer. He would save Israel because God knew a famine would come. God knew they're going to go into slavery. And I don't want you to worry or think, how will I take care of my people in the midst of slavery? How will I free them? How will I do any of those things? God says, I have control. Stephen is saying, he's sovereign. He's gracious. He gave to them Joseph. If you remember early in Joseph's life, the story went that God told him through dreams that he one day would be mighty. That he one day would be powerful. In fact, he says that all of his brothers and his parents would one day bow down. But when his brothers heard it, what did they do? They rejected him. They sold him into slavery. You wonder, how will the people of God ever end up in enslavement? It's through Joseph, because Joseph, if you remember the story, gets sold into slavery, yet he's faithful to God, and God raises him up, and he begins to be the leader of Potiphar's house, but then he's falsely accused, and he's put back in prison, but yet he's faithful to God, and God raises him up, and he explains some dreams to some men that eventually go and tell the king, there is a man in prison who has an amazing ability, and he's brought before Pharaoh to describe some dreams and interpret some dreams that Pharaoh has. And suddenly this man that was forsaken, this man that was sold, this man, I mean, do you hear the story of Jesus in this? This man who was not received by the ones who should have received him, he was enslaved, he He was jailed. He suffered. Yet in the end, what? God raised him up. And Joseph, if you remember the story out of Genesis, comes out of prison and becomes the man who leads all of Egypt. Why did God put Joseph in Egypt? So that his people might be saved. Even though they rejected, even though they didn't want anything to do with God's plan, God was still sovereign and God was still gracious and God still moved in spite of them. And at the end of Joseph's life, you remember what Joseph said? What all of you guys meant for evil. If you remember, they stood before Joseph and they realized who he was, that this is the brother they forsook. This is the brother they sold. And he stands before him and you think, what will this brother do to those who rejected him? And he looks at him and he says, what you meant for evil, God intended, God meant for good. You know what he was saying? You think this whole time that you were in control. But when you sold me, it was part of God's plan. When you rejected me, it was part of God's plan. Why? Because I needed to be here so one day I could save you. He lastly goes and speaks of Moses and Joseph. He goes on with the story and he says, a famine in verse 11 came over all of Egypt and Canaan. Great affliction with it. Our fathers could find no food, but when Jacob heard there was grain in Egypt, he sent our fathers there the first time. The second visit, Joseph made himself known to his brothers, and Joseph's family was disclosed to Pharaoh. Then Joseph sent word and invited Jacob, his father, and all his relatives to come to him. 75 persons in all went into Egypt. Jacob went down to Egypt, and there he and our fathers died. By the time they would leave Egypt, what was 75 people going in? Do you know how many would be coming out? Upwards of 2 to 3 million in 400 years. Did God keep his promise to Abraham? You better believe it. You better believe it. It says, from there they were removed to Shechem and laid in the tomb. So all these patriarchal parents, they died. They were buried there with Abraham in Shechem. It says, and he purchased that he had purchased for a sum of money from the sons of Hamor and Shechem. But as the time of the promise was approaching, which God had assured to Abraham, the people increased, the people multiplied in Egypt until there arose another king over Egypt who knew nothing about Joseph. And it was he who took shrewd advantage of our race, mistreated our fathers so that they would expose their infants and they would not survive. It was at this time that Moses was born. You know what he's saying in that section? He's saying that God is sovereign. And God is gracious, and God loves us and is in complete control. He says that a king arose who didn't know Joseph, who didn't know the children of Israel, and he went about killing all of the Hebrew boys. Literally, if you had a Hebrew child at that point, a boy, you were supposed to go and leave it in the elements, leave it outside, not care for it, not do anything. Many families, they were told, you will go down to the Nile and you will take your infant and you will throw it into the river. And in the midst of such a hopelessness, when you think God can't save, what does he do? He raises up Moses. And when his mother puts Moses in the water, we would say, by chance, is it by chance? It just so happened. Is that really the case? No, when the child goes in the water, he is found by Pharaoh's daughter. He is raised by his mother and has for 40 years the education. He basically is a son to Pharaoh. Think about that. Let that sink in a second. How improbable is Joseph? How improbable is Moses? And here is Moses. He gives the Hebrew people a savior, a deliverer. And at 40 years old, Moses realizes who he is and he sees his people and he rushes out, the text is going to say, when he sees an Egyptian beating one of the Hebrew slaves, he goes and he kills that man who's abusing the Hebrew, and instead of thanking him, instead of receiving him, instead of recognizing that God has given us a man in Pharaoh's house, they reject Moses. And the next day when Moses approaches his people, and he sees two of his own people fighting, he says, hey guys, stop it. Why are y'all fighting with each other? You're brothers. And they look at Moses and say, what are you going to do? Kill us and bury us in the sand like you did the Egyptian? And Moses realizes that he has to leave. And for 40 years, he wanders in Midian until God speaks to Moses at a burning bush. And he tells Moses, you're going to save your people. When you look at the section about the burning bush, and you go to verse 20, it says, it was at this time Moses was born. He was a lovely in the sight of God. So if they were asking about the blasphemy of Moses, what do you think of Moses? He says, listen, Moses was God's man. He was lovely in the sight of God. God had purposes and plans for Moses. I'm not blaspheming Moses. I know who he is. I know what God called him to do. And he goes on to describe it. He was nurtured 3 months in his father's homes. After he had been set outside, Pharaoh's daughter found him and took him away and nurtured him as her own. Moses was educated in all the learnings of Egypt. He was a man of power and words and deeds. What does he think about Moses? Does he hold him in high esteem? You better believe it. But when he was approaching the age of 40, it entered his mind to visit his brethren, the sons of Israel. When he saw that one of them was being treated unjustly, he defended him and struck vengeance for the oppressed by striking down the Egyptian. And he supposed that his brethren understood that God was granting them deliverance. He thought, they're going to receive me, that God was going to deliver through him. But they didn't understand. And on the following day, he appeared to them as they were fighting together. He tried to reconcile them in peace, saying, men, you're brothers. Why do you injure one another? But the one who was injuring his neighbor pushed him away, said, who made you ruler or judge over us? You do not mean to kill me as you killed the Egyptian yesterday, do you? At this remark, Moses fled and became an alien to the land of Midian, where he became the father of two sons. After 40 years passed, an angel appeared to him in the wilderness at Mount Sinai in the flame of a burning thorn bush. When Moses saw it, he marveled at the sight. He approached and looked more closely. There came the voice of the Lord. I am the Lord of your fathers, the Lord of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Moses shook with fear and would not venture to look. He couldn't even look at the burning bush. But the Lord said to him, take off the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is what? Holy ground. The sovereign God, full of grace, met Moses there and says, it's time to go get my people. He's faithful. Remember that statement about holy ground. We're going to come back to it. He says, I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I've heard their groans. I've come down to rescue them. Come now, I shall send you to Egypt. This Moses whom they disowned. You see, he's making the point here. He's saying, all of you who are in the sound of my voice, you don't realize that you have this pattern, that God is sovereign and God is gracious. But you know what you do to that sovereign, gracious God? You reject him. You ignore him. He sends you a savior, and what do? You send him away. He sends you another savior, and what do? You send him away. He sent Jesus, and what did you do? You killed him. You see the point that he's making? You see, over and over, he's saying, God moves and God stirs, but you reject. You're stubborn. You're stiff-necked. You're hard-headed. You're hard-hearted. And he's saying, you're looking at me and saying, I'm blasphemous. You're the one who is rejecting God. You're the one who is rejecting Moses. You're the one who rejects the law. He goes on, look at his words. It's just so interesting. He says, Moses, whom they disowned, said, who made you ruler and a judge? Is the one whom God sent to be ruler, both a ruler and a deliverer, with the help of the angel who appeared to him in the thorn bush? This man led them out. Moses performed wonders and signs in the land of Egypt, in the Red Sea, and in the wilderness for 40 years. This is the Moses who said to the sons of Israel, God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brethren. Who is he preaching about? Who is the prophet that will be raised up? It's Jesus. He's saying, I believe in Moses, and I believe the words of Moses. And what Moses said is, there is a prophet coming after me, and you need to listen to him. What did they do? They killed him. This is the one in verse 38, who was in the congregation in the wilderness together with the angel who was speaking to him on Mount Sinai, who was with our fathers. He received the living oracles to pass on to you. What are the living oracles? What are the living oracles? It's the law. It's the Ten Commandments. He says, I know about Moses. He's the one who was given the law. So let's talk about the law a moment. You know I love God. You know I understand who Moses is, and I'm not blaspheming Moses. I know his purpose. I know what God intended to do through him. But we rejected him as a people. We rejected Joseph, So let's look at the law. He says, you hold the law up and listen to these words. Our fathers were unwilling to be obedient to him, but repudiated him in their hearts, and they turned back to Egypt. That is saying, you know what? You talk about how much you love the law. You have to remember, you are descending from a people that when God sent Moses off the mountain with two tablets of stone that had 10 laws on it, he said, what did they find when Moses came off the mountain? What did God say? You need to leave right now with these tablets because these people, you ought to see what they're down there doing. And Moses leaves God's presence. He goes down the mountain with the law, and he finds that the people who have already said, you give us the law of God and we will obey it, he finds them already disobeying it. And they're worshiping a false god and they're complaining, saying, we are better off in Egypt. That means, you know, that's the equivalent of us saying today, you know what, I'm better off just going back to the life I had before I knew Jesus. Think about that. Is that not crazy? But that is how wicked our hearts are. That is how depraved we are. That is how far we will go in rejecting. He's saying, you say, I reject the law. What about our people? That is all we've ever done. And he says, you're doing the same thing today. You keep telling the world that you have the law and you're obeying the law. You can't keep the law. If you break the law, it's broken, right? If you sin once, what are you? If you steal once, what are you? If you murder once, what are you? And he's saying, you sit behind the law and you act as if you are so good. He says, you know what? We have always proven ourselves to be nothing more than disobedient. He says, I recognize it. I get it. You don't get it. I understand it. You don't understand it. They said to Moses, make for us gods who will go before us. Moses led us out of the land of Egypt, but we don't know what happened to him. He's been gone 40 days. At that time, they made a calf. They brought sacrifices and idols, and they were rejoicing in the works of their own hands. But God turned away and delivered them up to serve the host of heaven. As it is written in the book of the prophets, it was not me that they offered victims of sacrifices 40 years in the wilderness, was it, O house of Israel? You took along the tabernacle of Molech and the star of the god Ram for the images which you made to worship. I will also remove beyond Babylon. He says, not only did you worship these false gods at the base of the mountain there that day, he said, the entire time, what an insight into what was happening in Israel that we don't get out of the Old Testament. He says, the entire time you wandered in the wilderness, you know what you kept doing? You kept worshiping other gods consistently all the way through. And he says, and you stand here today and you say that you are keepers of the law. I really wish I had more time. Because he goes on in this message, and he just briefly speaks to the tabernacle. And I'll tell you what he says. He says, basically, you think that God can be confined to time and space. You think that God can be confined to a place. You think that you're special because you have a temple or a tabernacle. You know what he says? Listen, when Moses was out in the wilderness, did God find him? Did he worship God there? You better believe it. And when he stood there at the presence of the burning bush, God said, you better do what? You better take your shoes off. Why? Because this is holy ground. You know that where God is, that's holy ground? You know that where God is, that's where you can worship? Do you know where God is today? Right here. And he says, you say, I blaspheme the temple. He says, I'm just telling you there is no need for it anymore, because not only does God not dwell in things made with hands, he dwells inside of us. Did we make us? No. For the first time, he's rocking their world, saying, you think you can confine God? He is everywhere. And he lives within believers. And we don't need high priests. And we don't need sacrifices. And we don't need temples. And we don't need tabernacles. He said, I'm not the one who is blaspheming. You're the one that has misunderstood God. And you think you have a special privilege simply because you have a temple or a tabernacle. He says, when God wanted to meet Abraham, he met him in a pagan land. When he wanted to meet Moses, he met him in a desert at a burning bush. When he needed to speak to Joseph, he met him right there in Egypt. It didn't matter where the people of God were. They were able to worship and to honor and to follow and to obey God. And he says, here you guys are. You got this beautiful temple and you sit in it all day, every day, and you don't love them and you don't worship them and you don't serve them. You just say you do. You have an outward religion that has no inner reality. So what's the invitation? My goodness. It's one of the craziest invitations you'll ever have. For 51, you men, you are stiff-necked and uncircumcised. In your heart, in your ears, are always resisting the Holy Spirit. You are doing just as your fathers did. They killed the prophets. They persecuted the prophets. They killed those who had previously announced the coming of the righteous one. Betrayers, murderers, you have now become yourself. You who received the law as ordained by angels, yet you did not keep it. And it says that after he called them stiff-necked and hard-hearted, after he said that you had this outward religion but no inner reality, it says that they literally got so angry they gnashed their teeth, they covered their ears, and they bum-rushed Stephen. And they dragged him outside the city, and they stoned him to death. As Kevin comes, I just want you to consider today. Are you still resisting the grace and the mercy and the sovereignty of God in your life? Have you come to the place that you realize He loves you? He has saved you. Do you know His Word the way Stephen knows His Word so that you know how God is moving and when God is moving and why God is moving? Most of us, the biggest thing that happens in our life is we confine God to such a small box. We don't know Him. We just have our own little thoughts and opinions on Him. Do you know God in such a way that you know when and how He is moving according to His words? These people, they had every reason to know the truth, yet they didn't want to believe it. How do we know? Because they covered their ears. And they just simply said, I don't want to know the truth. If it's going to change the way I have to think about the law, if it's going to change the way I have to think about God, if it's going to change the way I have to think about Moses and the temple, then I don't want to know that God. I want to make God the way I want Him to be and quit messing with it. That's not what it means to follow God. Today, I ask you to consider the claims of Christ and to give your life to Him. Church, I ask you to consider the claims of Christ and align your life with who He is and where He's going and what He's doing. Set aside what you want God to be. Set aside how you want Him to act. And let God be God and let you serve Him and believe Him and obey Him. Church, let's stand. The altars are open. If you need Christ, will you come? Let God do in you what He desires.